Sorry.
And so I've got it both recording and streaming.
Hi there.
Oh, no.
That's surprising.
Here she goes with the voice. So Rachel, I thought I would watch for questions in the end. Yeah. I'm going to be sitting right here. Yeah. I'm going to do my little intro.
Thanks, you guinea pigs.
Did you guys give a little bit of background about what we're doing in this session?
30 seconds.
30 seconds?
Ask questions.
We're going to Facebook
questions.
Live.
Please ask questions.
There's a lot of people coming in from all over the country to listen, so there'll be lots of opportunities to ask questions and a little bit of explanation of the program, which you've probably already heard. But I'll
ten
be introducing,
seconds.
And then I'll be sort of taking questions.
8 seconds.
4, 3.
Not yet.
Good evening and welcome to Colorado Mountain College Leadville's Avalanche Science Webinar. My name is Rachel Pokrant and I have the great privilege of serving as the Leadville Campus Vice President and Dean. Colorado Mountain College is a multi-campus college located in and around the Rocky Mountain region of Colorado and serving 20,000 students in conventional degree programs, as well as in regionally focused programs, such as outdoor recreation leadership, ski area operations, and natural resources management. These programs speak to the unique landscape and geographical setting that we enjoy here in Leadville, Colorado. The Avalanche Science Program has been developed to serve the industries and individuals whose work and recreation relies on the knowledge and expertise in snow, weather, and avalanche science. We will be creating skilled technicians working for government land agencies, ski areas, guiding operations, or in mountain rescue fields. This program is the very first certificate program of its kind in the nation, both in its curriculum scope and the nature of the partnership that exists between the program and the Colorado Avalanche Information Center, which maintains offices on our campus here in Leadville. We are delighted to offer this webinar to interested students in preparation for our first cohort class beginning in the fall of 2017. And we have on hand an expert panel made up of faculty and instructors who are also practitioners in the field. We will take questions from the room here in Leadville and from Facebook Live, which is running concurrently. To start us off, I would like to ask our panel to introduce themselves, speak a little bit about their involvement in the CMC Avalanche Science Program. And maybe, Roger, you can kick us off.
Yeah, you got to start with me, huh?
Yep.
Hi, everybody. My name is Roger Coit. I'm a full-time faculty here with Colorado Mountain College, and I teach in the Emergency Medical Services Department, as well as Outdoor Studies, and teaching courses from avalanche safety to EMS to wilderness medicine. I've been working with the team here over the last couple of years on the curriculum, and we've had a group here this afternoon for an open house visit, and it's been a really wonderful afternoon, so excited to have people logging in online. And I hope to see you and be able to answer your questions tonight as well. Thanks.
I'm Brian Lazar, the Deputy Director of the Colorado Avalanche Information Center. I'm the former Executive Director of the American Institute of Avalanche Research and Education. So I've spent many years developing avalanche course curriculum, and I've been involved with Ethan and Roger and Kelly and others in developing some of the curriculum for this program. And I kind of first got into the snow science and avalanche safety world through mountain guiding, where I worked full-time as a mountain guide in a variety of snow climates for 10 or 12 years there before I kind of started getting into consulting work and then ultimately moved to the Avalanche Center. And I work for Ethan.
And I'm Ethan Green. I'm the director of the Colorado Avalanche Information Center. And I've been working with CMC. Roger and other people's over the course of about 5 years now to open the office here and to work on this program. It's been the culmination of a lot of work and a lot of different iterations of adding ideas around to really try to bring an operational training program in Avalanche work. So I'm very excited to see this program launch.
Fantastic. We are delighted to have you here. Thank you so much. We're going to kick it off with Roger, who's going to give a quick program overview. And then we'll go to the floor and to Facebook Live for questions.
Thanks, Rachel. I had to write stuff down because I'm too nervous to try to remember it or be articulate otherwise. So forgive me for reading, but hello, everyone. As Rachel mentioned just a moment ago, starting in the fall of 2017, Colorado Mountain College in Leadville is rolling out our brand new Avalanche Science Program certificate as a snow, weather, and avalanche field technician. The program is housed under the Ski Area Operations Program here on campus, and that program's been here operating for several decades. So we have a long tradition of offering snow, winter-based program here in Leadville. And the Avalanche Science Program was a perfect fit for us. We started brainstorming this program with Dr. Green and Dr. Kelly Elder back in 2010, I think. We knew we wanted to offer a more comprehensive program in avalanche science to fill a gap in what we felt was being offered currently in the United States. We began work in earnest developing the program, I think, back in 2014 as a cooperative effort between the college and the Colorado Avalanche Information Center, particularly, as we've said, with Brian and Ethan here. We really worked hard to design a program to provide a solid baseline of knowledge and skills for workers in and around avalanche terrain. Developing the program from the ground up, we sought input from a broad range of industry leaders to help us design a robust curriculum that would really serve student and industry needs. We're excited to train skilled and safe workers for snow avalanche industry sectors as broad as ski patrollers, and ski area snow safety workers, regional and local avalanche forecasters, transportation forecasters, mountain guides of all types, rescue providers such as search and rescue, fire, EMS, and law enforcement, environmental scientists, government technicians, field researchers, educators, and even military specialists. We built-in program flexibility, which allows students to choose to enroll in the full year, two-year program, or to take select courses for focused studies for a broad range of professionals as well as aspiring snow professionals. So some key program features I wanted to highlight. We're offering a substantial depth and duration of studies under highly qualified faculty. The program's made up of 11 courses or 21 credit hours of study, totaling nearly 500 hours of instructor contact time, which is a significant amount of involvement for avalanche science and avalanche safety studies in the United States. Significantly more than the traditional progression of avalanche safety courses. Through the program, students will follow the snowpack, weather, and avalanches from the first snows to the spring meltout. And beyond a solid base of snow, weather, and avalanche studies, we offer expanded coursework in mountain meteorology, avalanche and weather forecasting, organizational avalanche safety operations, as well as field internships with a range of our industry partners. These are just a few of the aspects of this program that we think set us apart from the traditional avalanche training progression offered in the United States. We also think we have the perfect location for this program, having a modern campus with really cool, smart classrooms. We're sitting in one right now, pretty technologically enabled. Our campus is at 10,000 feet. We have access to great terrain for our field work. And not one, but soon two new state-of-the-art remote sensing weather stations for program work. We're building a one-of-a-kind live outdoor winter laboratory with the ability to hold online class sessions and broadcasting directly from a snow pit out there in the field. We're also offering a unique delivery method for the program. We've built the program to accommodate working professionals through a hybrid course format. It's a mix of online and live coursework. We will hold three intensive on-campus sessions spread out through the winter season, lasting from 4 to 9 days for each of these intensive sessions. In between these on-campus sessions, students will remain engaged in their studies at home, working online, taking advantage of the flexibility that this hybrid format offers. And I think I can speak for our program development team here. and say that we're extremely excited to be rolling out this project. It's been a great process. Building something like this from the ground up, and it's really been a fun, big learning and progression. And we're excited in the prospect of having you as students in the program. Thank you, and I think it's time to get on to some questions, most likely. And I wrote all that and read it really well.
Great job, Roger. Okay, so we'd like to open it up for questions from the room, and also those of you on Facebook Live, please type your questions in, and we will ask them at the panel here. Would anybody in the room like to kick it off? Yeah, go ahead.
So part of the Colorado that I wanted to make sense, you guys have worked pretty hard to design the coursework itself and the curriculum, and then you also have forecasters in the classroom as well, too. Is that correct?
Yeah, some of the staff from the Avalanche Information Center will do some of the teaching. We're not sure. That'll probably change a little bit as far as who's actually taking leading roles. A lot of the courses have been developed so that there'll be different working Avalanche professionals that come in and teach different pieces of it, and some of the CAAC staff will be part of that. In addition to that, there's an office here on campus, and so students will be able to interact with this ongoing operational Avalanche forecasting program. People that are doing this stuff every day.
So, I mean, it definitely seems like you guys have a pretty strong relationship with the program itself. Aside from the curriculum and actually being in the classroom, do you guys have any other connection to the program? Maybe like possible internship type of work or stuff like that?
Yeah, the center will be one of the sources for internships. The Avalanche Information Center does regional backcountry forecasting for recreation, and then also transportation forecasting for the state transportation system in Colorado. So we're trying to get internship locations that cover a lot of different Avalanche safety applications. CAC will be one, but we also hope to have guiding operations, ski areas, other sort of data collection groups that are going into Avalanche training that also provide those sorts of opportunities. Really, so students will have a chance to see a lot of the different work opportunities out there and hopefully help them figure out a direction that they want to pursue.
I think, and I'd add on to that, Matt, too, on top of just the idea of visiting different operational sites and operational contexts, some students may be able to engage in a work-study process at their workplace, for instance. So if they're already working, for instance, with a ski patrol and they want to attend the program, we will be able to design an at-workplace experience where they'll be able to accomplish learning objectives for the internship and keep getting work and getting paid and the exposure within the house where they are. Thanks. Good question.
Roger, can you speak maybe or other members of the panel to how the program compares to other Avalanche safety courses? There are obviously other options at other colleges out there, and where do we sit in that paradigm?
Yeah, I can take a first stab at that. So, the traditional kind of Avalanche safety structure in the United States now is recreational professional courses where students show up and have fairly intense interactions with their instructors in short course formats, so 3 days for a level one, for example, up to, let's say, a week long for professional certification courses. And all of those courses are pretty intense in short time frames, and you get a lot of information in a very short time period. I have yet to talk to an Avalanche instructor who felt like they had too much time with their students on an Avalanche course. And we've always dreamed and thought about what we'd be able to do if we just had more time with the students. If they could leave a class, go out and apply some skills, come back with some questions, come back and get some more coaching and mentorship, and how neat that would be. And that not only neat, but really beneficial to the learning process. And, this kind of structure allows for that type of educational approach.
Who else is doing it?
Nobody.
Well, I commend you for your initiative and your creativity. I think it's just a natural, perfect fit. This campus in particular, Colorado College. And I guess one of my questions would be, going back to just the recreational user, there somewhere in the curriculum just for Americans, you know, that put someone outside the head and say, hey, before you go out the back, you know, here's what you need, here's what you may face, and there's a lot of backcountry music, not especially about HUD system, which is so popular, and golf in one sense, but then there's a growing danger out there.
Well, there, it's sort of yes and no. So this program as a whole is really designed to get people that are going to be doing this stuff as part of their job. But people can also take individual courses. So if they have, either as a professional or as a recreationalist, if there's a specific topic that they want to learn more about and they want to take a course, they can do that without taking the whole program. But the CMC also has a recreational avalanche safety program. That will be ongoing, and the work of the Avalanche Center providing products for recreationalists, people going to huts, will also be part of this. And one of the things that we hope that this program will interact with those two existing programs will be providing data, more information from the remote weather stations, from the study plots, from the students working in the field, to improve the local forecasts, to give more site-specific information to people that are going to specific huts, and to increase the avalanche safety culture, really, in Leadville. So although this program doesn't necessarily address the avalanche awareness piece, it fits into sort of a broader program and enhances things that are already happening.
And I would add, we will continue offering our recreational level avalanche classes that are already very popular. We have 5 or 6 or 7 different offerings per winter for recreationalists wanting to get initial training as well.
Are they 1 to 3 days?
Yes. Yeah, so like the kind of the introduction recreational avalanche course, besides just an awareness, 1 hour, half day kind of one, is a level one course, which is traditionally about 3 days, or 24 hours. And that basic level of training is actually a prerequisite.
And we'll continue to do like evening awareness courses like we've done in the past here on campus, and hopefully get some of the students involved in this program with some experience in presenting and teaching and talking about general avalanche awareness.
I would expect your graduates would go out spread them to avalanche gospel.
We hope so.
It's one of the stated outcomes for the program is to pass the good word on.
Great. We do have a question from Facebook Live from Christopher Peterson. And Christopher, if you're listening in, hopefully still, send us another message and tell us where you are coming from. We'd love to know where you're patching in from. So Christopher says, for live web classes, do you have estimated days of the week and times of the day that those classes will be held?
We don't yet. As we've built the curriculum, so right now we're building the syllabi and the particular lectures and so forth. We have the schedule of the on-campus sessions nailed down, and then we have the date ranges where the online classes will occur. It'll be a mix between online classes that you work independently on, that's called asynchronous learning, and then there'll be a few classes, for instance, the forecasting class, which will meet once a week or twice a week for an hour or two. And that will be students at home need to be in front of their computers during that time for the class session to occur. And those dates are coming soon, but when we have nailed down, for instance, if we have Brian or Ethan teaching the forecasting class, what day and at what time they'd like to do it, we bear in mind we're really cognizant of the need to have our schedule for live remote classes still work for someone who's a working professional in the field as well. So that's the best answer I can give you right now, but we will be developing that and releasing it as soon as we can through the summer. Great question.
Other questions from
the
room?
Yeah, so students that already have the level 1 or 2, like the area of curriculum, or I understand it's changing to like back in the flow, are you guys off the bridge course, or will you guys facilitate that, or what's going to happen with that?
Yeah, so CMC is becoming a provider of the new AAA pro courses, and the Pro One will be part of this program. So if you're taking the entire program as part of it, you will get the knowledge and skills and be tested to the standard to get the Pro One certification. And so as part of that, the campus will be able to provide the bridge course. The bridge course isn't designed yet, so we don't know exactly how that will fit into it, but it looks like it's a fairly flexible course with a fairly short format. So it'll really be whether there's enough, sort of a critical mass of people that we can produce a bridge course for.
Well, yeah, you know, we as I mentioned earlier, we have a regular host of avalanche, recreational avalanche classes that go on in and above this program starting, and so a bridge course might be a part of that, those offerings as well. We're going to kind of be, a one-stop shop for a lot of levels and aspects of avalanche training and avalanche awareness and regional avalanche training as well.
Yeah, so the bridge course will be from the existing level to the new Pro One.
And it will have to, also have an evaluation.
So maybe we could go into some questions about the nuts and bolts of enrolling. Can you talk a little bit about the overall costs of the program?
We have information available, all of this coming up on our link on the web. You'll go to the Colorado Mountain College website directly and just enter into the search bar Avalanche Science Program. And in there will be a lot of different resources. The folks who came today for the live session received an information packet, as well as the folks who RSVP for the session right now online. Our administrative coordinator is going to be sending you the same set packages. For other students who aren't on that list, logging onto our website will be the access point. And in there, you'll find a wealth of different information about the program, up to and including the anticipated cost for the program. Cost for the program is going to be based on your tuition costs, and tuition rates are based on your residency for the college. So more than I could probably talk about in the presentation, but you'll take the number of credit hours and then apply that to the credit hour cost for your in-state, out-of-state, in-district, or in-service area tuition rate. Additionally, there are course charges for a few of the courses that add to the total amount. And there will be there are some college fees associated with registering for the college, things like I think instructional technology. I'm looking over at my boss to look for a nod. So we give you guidance on figuring out a rough estimate on how much the program is going to cost you. And then information to contact me is on the website as well, and or our student services department that where you can speak with registrations and also financial aid if you're interested in applying for scholarships or finding other funding sources.
I think we have some questions too regarding the hybrid course format. And in education, sometimes we have these words that nobody else knows what we're talking about. So maybe as a team, you can talk a little bit about what taking a hybrid course really means. We've talked about sort of coming in from different type classes, but how will that look over a semester?
It's a mix, and I'll let these guys kind of finish where I start, but it's a mix of live, you're on campus attending classrooms. These will be intensive sessions to try to maximize your time away from home that you have to be here on campus. And then when those sessions end, you'll continue to engage in coursework doing online work.
Yeah, so like Roger was talking about before, we really tried to design this program so that you could do it while you were working in a job. So say you were working, say, for a ski area, and you wanted to try to focus on the snow safety aspect of that operation. You could continue that work and do this program. So there's there's three intensive sessions where you're going to have to come on campus, and we tried to schedule those in a way that they would be the least intrusive to people that were doing this sort of work. So there's one in September, there's one right after Thanksgiving, and then there's one, I think, in March. So those are going to be times, somewhere between like 4 and 6 days, I think, on different ones, where you're here face-to-face with instructors. It's going to be intense, long days, packing a lot into a short amount of time. Then outside of that, there's sort of two options. There'll be some courses where you can kind of work on your own with access to instructions. If you have help, basically office hours where you can get some additional help, ask additional questions, but really it'll be you working at your own pace. Then there'll be other courses where you're either here on campus, if you are local, or tuning in online to be part of a virtual classroom. So it'll be a classroom in the traditional sense, but the option to attend or to attend online, and that's the hybrid piece. Those are courses like forecasting, where we'll be doing some, really going through the forecasting process, talking about the fundamentals of how to frame your problem, how to collect data, and then students will be working together to put together forecasts and present them to each other. You won't have to be on campus to do that, but you will have to be online at a specific time.
Great, and if I'm a student somewhere else in the country right now tuning in on Facebook Live, then I think I'm going to let go for a course for a long weekend. Where am I going to stay and what am I going to eat?
We've reserved some rooms in the Mountain View Residence Hall for folks traveling into town who need accommodation during the course. Information about that as well is available online in our frequently asked questions section. We have room rates. Don't quote me on this. I think it's something like $22.50 a night in a shared room during the program. And we also have, you also have access to the campus cafeteria. If you want to do your meals here on campus, that's an option. There's a kitchen in the residence hall where you can cook for yourself, and then, of course, a lot of local restaurants that you can visit. So really, it would be, we're excited to have students potentially traveling to our location from other geographical regions because, for instance, in a class like forecasting, they may be looking at a snowpack that's geographically and climatically different than what we have here in Leadville, and that kind of cross-pollination of information, I think, will broaden the learning experience for the students. And so we're kind of grinning and smiling how clever we are that we came up with that idea. So hopefully that works out. Please let me know.
Other questions from the audience? Yes, sir.
So actually, kind of going back to new, newly designated professional area courses. So with that, so you guys are saying the Area 1 Pro is actually a part of the program here. And then so far as the Area 2, is it kind of gearing you up to actually take that second course, like during, right after, or maybe further down the road? Or what would be like the ideal time to kind of go for that Area 2?
So the Pro 2 in the new paradigm, like the current Level 3, requires a certain amount of work experience to entry. So this program does not require that level of experience, and so that's why coming out of this, you'll end up with a credential of the Pro 1, but you'll need to get the experience to qualify for that Pro 2 course. You may be able to get that through internship or additional work that you're doing surrounding this, and it may be that at some point this program has students that have that level of experience, and this campus will be able to provide that Pro 2 course. But at this point, we didn't want to build the course around that. We wanted to make sure that anybody who's interested in doing this kind of work could come with a fairly low level of experience, a recreational course as the prerequisite, and be able to come and thrive and work through the program. So that's why we haven't targeted that higher level of professional training as the exit point.
Gotcha. We may have students that enter the program that have a great deal of experience, and they can carry that forward and be eligible to test that.
No, I mean, just maybe one point of clarification. So the level two course is what current people in the professional
we're going to be separated, so the recreational level two won't look like the current level twos. Pro one will look somewhat like that, but have a graduation component. And those courses are going to be areas just one of those elements. Those pro course providers.
And CMC will be another one of those pro course providers.
Fantastic. Okay, we've got some more questions coming in from Facebook Live. We have Justin Peacock, who tells us we're sounding really good. Thanks,
awesome.
Justin.
Thanks, Justin. we're kind of nervous. So
yeah. So Justin would like, said he's curious as to how many students would be admitted into the program at a time.
I'll grab that one. We've capped the enrollment for this first cohort of students at 12. That's a good round number. We're used to dealing with our outdoor studies programs that take students out into, you know, harder environments and more dangerous terrain. So we're keeping it at 12 to keep a safe instructor to student ratio. Plus, it's a great instructor to student ratio for good teaching and learning. Smaller classes, I think everybody appreciates those. We will have, and we've reserved some space beyond that, maybe as many as 15 students in some of our lecture-only classes. I think the lecture class of snow and avalanches has no fieldwork components, so I think we'll let 15 students into that. So we may have folks taking individual classes for special interest or continuing professional development. And coming in and out of our main cohort of as many as maxed out at 12. That makes sense.
Great. And there is an application process, correct, Roger?
There is. So that as well you can find in your packets today, or if you were RSVP'd for the Facebook Live event, you'll be receiving this packet. If you're not one of those groups, you can log on to the college's website. Just put Avalanche Science Program in the search bar. And in there, you will find all this informational, pages, as well as an online application that should go live early next week. We anticipate we had some bugs with converting our hard copy stuff onto the web, but all of it should be there to work through. And I'll say, if you have any questions as you embark on that application process, I'd say even before you embark on the application process, contact me through the college. My contact information is also available on that webpage, so I can kind of discuss with you and give you a game plan for working through the application. The application itself, do you think you want to talk about that at all? Or put you on the spot?
Sure.
Yeah, we're happy to talk about that.
Well, there's a series of prerequisites that's really designed to make sure that people are successful in this program. There's a variety of ways to satisfy those prerequisites. We really try to give people a path and some idea of what we're looking for students coming into the program, but also to give them a lot of leeway for different types of life and work experience. But there's some basic skills that you can get through different college coursework, first aid credential, and some basic avalanche safety coursework that we want everyone to come into the program with. So that we all kind of start at the same, a similar level, base set of skills, and have something to build off of.
Great, we have a few more things coming in from Facebook Live. I'm going to have a nice comment that I'd like to read. Ariel Krolik says, 15 years ago, I went to CMC in Leadville and SIBO for school and avalanche training. Being the only female in lots of classes at that time, I highly recommend CMC. I still use all my knowledge, even living in Vermont. Thanks for letting us know where
Thanks.
You are, Ariel. Okay, we have another question from Christopher Peterson. He says, how likely will it be to obtain different internships with CAT skiing operations, snow safety ski patrollers, CAIC forecasters in the first year? And he does say, assuming you have a clean resume. Are you sure you do, Christopher?
I'll start with that one. The internships will most likely see students at workplaces in their second year of studies. If a student comes to us with perhaps already at a workplace and it would be a fit that was is appropriate for that time in the program, that would be acceptable. But we're thinking that before students go into internships, we'd probably like to have them completed their first year of studies.
Yeah, and then just to add to that, we're still building a lot of the internship opportunities, but we've had very positive feedback from industry groups that fit all of the classes that Christopher's asking for.
Yeah.
Christopher, we really want to know where you're writing in from. Tell us where you are.
Tell us where you are.
Right now, I've got you in like Nepal on the top of the
It's in the
Maybe since we talked a little bit about the application, you can talk about the application deadline and then when potential students might hear and then when the program actually starts.
I've been doing a lot of the administrative stuff, so I'll keep taking these and throw some at me if you want me to stop. But we're taking applications throughout the year. It's a rolling application process. We have a recommended deadline of June 15th for students applying for this fall's first program of students. We picked a date to try to get people on the wagon and get them working towards preparing for the program, and it's nice for us to know how many we're going to be dealing with. If we, once we've got those applications, we're going to convene the application review committee, which will probably be us and perhaps some other faculty here on the campus, evaluate them based against the criteria that we are looking for students in the program, and then make a decision within a couple of weeks, I think, easily before July 1 about acceptance in the program, if not sooner. You can always submit an application before the June 15th deadline, and if we get several before that time, I don't think there's any reason we wouldn't do an early evaluation of applications at that time. So you don't have to wait by June 15th. You probably ought to at least get it in by June 15th. If we don't fill the program after that deadline, we will continue to accept applications. We'd like to get 12, and we're unsure what kind of demand we have. Based on what we've had for visitors here today and the folks lining up online, we think these seats are going to be pretty hot tickets. So the June 15th and the decisions by July 1st, I think, will probably be a good date line to hold in your head.
Fantastic. And
the
start date for the actual program, what's the first day of class?
First day of class is the first day of fall semester. So I got that here. I should know that. It's late August. It is the standby.
29th.
Of August.
Yes. That's my first guess. Anyone else? There's a tenor.
A couple of the programs start on the very first day of the semester. Some of them don't start until our first on-campus intensive session on the 23rd. Of September. So basically it's late September or late August for the program start. I'm sorry, I don't have that exact date. 20 minutes ago. It's clearly on the college's webpage.
And do you need to report that Christopher is in British Columbia?
Nice.
And apparently Christopher has already visited the campus and is raring to go. So thanks, Christopher, out there. Questions from the room?
I got one. As someone that's been a ski patroller for a long time and a canteen guy, I've had a lot of experience and time for numerous years. What can I expect to learn more than what I already have, other than like an Air 2 that I took 7 years ago? What can I look forward to as far as being there for such a long time? You've got a good idea of what you think you know and what you should know. Is this something, a program I should be looking forward to? Or?
Yeah, I think that's a great question, Rich, and absolutely. So there's a few different things I think that you can look forward to in this program. One is some real basic knowledge about snow and avalanche phenomena. And you've probably got this in the courses that you've taken before, and you've probably talked about it with other people on the patrol and other people in the guided community, but you probably never really got a chance to go through the material in a systematic way. And so the chance to go through the material at a reasonable pace, in a systematic way, with a variety of people that have worked in that field and studied it, will give you the opportunity to really mull through that stuff and make sure that that foundation, your understanding conceptually of how these processes work, that's an opportunity that I don't think we usually get on the job too much. The other thing I would say is that working on the job, a lot of times when you come in, you know, there's an existing program, and you sort of get the fire hose of like where everything is, how everything works, you know, what the pace of the day is, what happens on snow days, all of that. But you don't often really get an idea of how to step back and think about why that was constructed and whether it's constructed in the best way. And so that's another part that we're going to be covering in this program, is really how do you define an avalanche safety problem, and then how do you construct a systematic solution to it and then carry that out. So really stepping back and saying, like, I'm dealing with skiers at a cat skiing operation. We've got X amount of terrain. We've got this sort of time frame that we're dealing with. How are we going to construct our program to safeguard these people in a different way? How are we going to collect data to try to make good decisions throughout the ebb and flow of these avalanche cycles that we have to deal with? And then looking at, maybe you're familiar with the cat skiing piece because you've done that in this area, but we're going to take that to an industrial work site. We're going to do it for a highway. We're going to look at it from a backcountry guiding perspective. But how do you really define your avalanche safety problem and then build a program around it to try to safeguard your assets as much as you can?
Exposure to different operational contexts and different operations avalanche safety plans.
Yeah,
unless you've kind of bounced around a lot with a ton of different kinds of avalanche jobs, we all get it into our own kind of, you know, backyard, because that's the job, right? So that's what you do. And you probably already see the way you treat avalanches in the cat skiing side of things is different than the way you treat managed avalanches in the ski area side of things, just in your own workplace. So it will, I think, broaden the perspective of how your particular operation fits into the context of avalanche work at large.
Would it be something that I could take internationally to, through experience, and then maybe go do that the perpetual winter?
Yeah, well, I think you can. I think a lot of what we're trying to do is sort of build practitioners that have a really broad perspective. So like, kind of like what Brian's saying, you know your backyard, you know your operations. If you go to New Zealand to work at Skiria, it's going to be the same sort of application, but it's a new backyard that you're dealing with. So hopefully what we'll do is we'll give you a good set of tools for how to look at that new operation, how to figure out how you fit into it, and how to improve it.
The scope of courses, too. I don't think there are many forecasting, we have like some other forecasting programs in the U.S. I think how we intend to integrate meteorology, forecasting, field observations, and fundamental snow physics classes together as a whole, I think, is a big picture view.
Yeah, I think that kind of falls into some of the stuff that you've already been exposed to, but having a different pace to it. So, a lot of us end up doing weather forecasting for our operations, even though we never really been trained in weather forecasting, but it's just one piece. You have to get it done, you have to get out on the hill, you have to take care of other stuff. And so being able to kind of follow some of these events, having other people to talk to about them, both students and instructors, and then taking the time to really sort of diagnosing them and then looking back to see, how you did, how things went right, how things went wrong. That's a really valuable piece that a lot of times we don't get on the job just because we've got so many other things to do.
think the way these kind of these courses and trainings are rolled out is we make anyone more nimble and flexible and then moving around, not only in different areas, but to different jobs. You just be able to kind of hit the ground running more than you.
Yeah, we tend to get pigeonholed in our applications because that's what we get trained to do. A lot of this training comes in the job, and so you burn that application, that operation. And like Ryan's saying, I think what we're shooting for is sort of a more general approach where you can come in and not necessarily see the paradigm of the last operation that you were in, but in this more kind of broad avalanche safety perspective, figure out how you can fine-tune things and how you can make your place in a position where you're dealing with a problem that was not an existing program. How do you build it? How do you implement it?
Hopefully get a look at some different operations and some industry standards and building out and safety programs.
Yeah, and I think, I certainly hope that we're going to be able to use some international situations in these, because I think Brian and I both had the experience of seeing some other operations, both through colleagues and through work experience, and the variety of problems that are out there. It's a great one. Just a review.
Thanks, Rich. Great question.
So there may be some folks in the room who may be on Facebook Live who are getting jazzed about this opportunity, but maybe they're also feeling a little bit intimidated, like, I can ski some, but I'm not an expert skier. How is that going to play in when you take students out of the field? What sort of backcountry skiing skills
that they need to have. I mean, fieldwork is part of this course structure. So you need to be able to move around those. But you don't need to be, a world champion, a free skier to be able to practice in the program. Nor do you have to be a really good skier, but you need to be able to move around in the snow in order to kind of complete the fieldwork.
Well, we've talked a lot about this.
Yeah, and I think we've really tried to build it so that, I think Brian's absolutely right, like being able to move on the snow is the important piece. How that can be accomplished in a lot of different ways. And again, we want people to come out of this with a well-rounded set of skills. So you're going to have to ski. You're going to have to ride a snowmobile. You're going to get to do both of those things. You can accomplish this program with probably intermediate skiing skills. You can do a lot of this on snowshoes. We're going to want, hopefully people can do a lot of this on snowmobiles as well. We're going to want people to interact with all of these different travel mechanisms and really be familiar with them, because that's part of, again, being a well-rounded professional. And being able to use them for the right application in the workforce.
Yeah. With any of these jobs, we have much more required than others. So it's just part of the workplace training. Snow, and sometimes that means I don't think motor, but see a snowmobile, see how it works. Maybe the tool you get on your job.
Yeah, and you may be an expert snowmobiler. You can do a lot of this with a snowmobile. But there's probably going to be a few applications where you need to be able to trek around on skis a little bit. So you're going to have to walk the snowshoes or skis and walk a little bit too.
Sounds like fun. Great. Other questions from the room? Yes, sir.
So actually, so far as like forecasting goes, I mean, you guys use a lot of technology to be able to provide the forecast and give. As far as like, we kind of look at the weather plot here on campus. So you kind of touched on this a little bit, but we're essentially going to learn to upkeep those, and then also how to interpret all this information as well, and essentially the ins and outs of weather station, everything we essentially need to know.
So, yes. the existing curriculum and the core curriculum of this program is really focusing on the interpretation. So being able to understand how those data are collected, whether it's manual or remote sensing, auto automated weather stations, and then sort of interpret those data to create your forecasts. So really understanding the pros and cons of the data, what to look for, how to use it. We do have the weather station, and we are going to be learning some of the basics of what happens at those weather stations in terms of how you interpret those data. We have our eyes set on building some elective courses that are more specialized, and so that'll probably be coming in year two of the program. And so one of those that we hope to build is really an intensive piece on how to build and maintain those weather stations. So that may not be a core skill for every avalanche worker, but there's going to be some people that really need to know that stuff, and so we want to provide that as well. So the core piece will be on using the data, and there'll be some other opportunities to actually build, construct, and maintain those stations.
Okay, and then along those lines as well, too, and then, you know, another piece of it as well, like DBMS, you know, being able to manage the systems, and do you think that would be applied to these electric courses too, or? Right, yeah. So, I mean, essentially, you know, I mean, like, you know, at the CIC, I mean, like, for example, like, you guys keep track of all, like, the accident reports and stuff like that, and then make sure you guys use some sort of tool to actually, you know, to be able to collect all that information effectively and so forth. I mean, would you be learning that in that course as well, too, or, I mean?
So, I think that's a really good question, and this is one of the pieces that I think I'm really excited about, though. Around this program, and that one of the things that's really different about this program compared to the other kind of professional avalanche training is that this is part of the college. It's part of this existing educational system, and the college offers a lot of coursework and skills in existing programs that can be applied towards avalanches, GIS information systems. You know, we've even looked at the catalog at like some of the welding courses. Some of that stuff you will learn in this program, but I think what sets this program apart is that there's the opportunity to really dig into that. So if what you see in your future is that you're going to need to know more about databasing and how to do information storage and sorting, there's courses here that already exist that you can take. And that as part of this program, you can do a lot of that coursework around avalanche data applications.
Okay. And then depending on kind of what your interest is in avalanche, like maybe operation and avalanche application, later, maintaining and tracking data. So those kind of core skills that you can talk about, you get to kind of put together as well. You can see how these different operations, us throw away an example, are collecting.
This is a life skill. Does that answer your question? Yeah, no, absolutely answers my question. I kind of started another question now as well, too. So, what are some of these other classes you're kind of talking about? I think, Roger, you mentioned like hydrology and so forth.
Yeah, the college has programs, natural resource management, ski area operations, outdoor recreation leadership. Humanities courses, so you know we're a full service community college. We offer certificates like this. We offer associate's degrees. We even offer a selected number of bachelor's degrees to the college. So there are a lot of ancillary courses that you might be able to add to specialize within this framework of avalanche science as well. So hydrology being one of them, GIS that you can mention.
Yeah, well, especially this campus. I mean, some of the main programs, correct me if I'm wrong, on this campus are, there's the whole outdoor leadership piece. And so there's a lot of coursework, even you could take as electives, if you were focusing on this program, that would be directly applicable from backcountry travel or interiorizing. There's the first aid part that Roger's very involved with. And then there's a ski area operations program, which this program is part of, but there's other coursework in that program. And then the other one is the natural resources portion here, which has a lot of really good technical courses, has a lot of like, some of the GIS work. You know, they have a world-class laboratory here for some of the water quality, some of the work that we do for the EPA. So So the intersection of that, this program in some ways sits at the intersection between the natural resources, the outdoor leadership, and the security operations, and overlaps with all of them. So I think students focusing on this program can slide into each one of those other three and gain a lot of skills, and those courses already exist.
Right, when you start to get a lay of the land, you know, how much work in the landscape, what course you think you can be surprised at the end of a role like what Ethan and I do now for writing courses, you know, it's
tremendously helpful. Writing part of our
job is community.
Yeah.
So you might be surprised that, like, yeah, maybe taking a writing course to be a technical comment to the public might be a really crucial skill. It's what we look for in our interview.
So I have another question here from Facebook Live, and that is, you spoke about how students will be able to record observations as part of their course in their own geographical location.
The question is, will the students have access to each other's data, maybe the learning management system, or anything that somebody said that they're all looking at, the data from around the country, is that anything?
Yes, it'll
depend a little bit on the course. So there are courses, the first year there's one course on observations itself. And so, some of that will involve the outdoor classroom that Roger's been talking about. But people that, especially if they're working in other parts of the country, will be able to come here, to gain some basic skills, and then go collect those data outside. Especially if they're doing in like a forecasting course, we'll be doing forecasting for different parts of the country. And so we'll be using existing data networks to accomplish those tasks.
And some of that data might be from other students in the program that
absolutely
went out and dug that snow profile or did that weather.
Yeah, and certainly students that are collecting data locally that will go into the database of the Avalanche Center, and they'll have access to each other's data and public data from this area and data from the forecasters as well.
Great question.
Minutes here. Other questions from the audience today or
at CMC level? Yes, sir. You talked a lot about how to relate this program into the professional side and all the different avenues that you could take on the professional side. So the recreationalist, or is this not for a recreationalist? Would this be something that you just kind of stick to the recreational avalanche courses or whatever, or is this something that's like kind of like a recreational, that's something that's like a kind of a geek, is this something that you want to do?
Well, for in my opinion, you'd have to be a really exuberant recreationalist to want to do the entire program, because it's a pretty big commitment. If it's something that you're going to go into as a profession, it's a much more reasonable bar. But one of the things that I think this program really offers the exuberant recreationalist, or the geek, as you say, are some of the a la carte offerings, taking some of the coursework without maybe the entire program. So, like the Snow and Avalanche series, there's a lot of information that you're going to get, and it's going to be delivered at a fairly reasonable technical level over, again, sort of a long time frame to give you the chance to digest it. So it would be way more than you would get in a level one, two, or probably even three in today's paradigm. It's something that you probably would get in a higher level college courses, but it'll be the topics and the level and the presentation will be geared towards the recreationalist and entry-level avalanche worker, so much more digestible. So that would be something that I think would be very, very useful for the recreationalist.
I wouldn't doubt that the list of recreationalists that would want this depth of information in doing the whole program. I wouldn't put it past some folks, absolutely. I can imagine coming out of 2 years of this program as a recreationalist having, boy, a good solid background and, you know, a lifetime's worth of information is great.
Yeah, I mean, it's going to give you a very, a fairly tight framework for how to approach some of these problems. And so you're going to pick your partners very carefully. Because you're going to want them to be dancing to the same beat.
When you look through just like kind of the content of just the snow and of course, and just stuff that you're just no doubt.
Yeah, and it's not to say, I mean, I think that a lot of this is applicable to recreation. It's just
depth.
It's depth, yeah.
And thanks for your time.
Oh, yeah.
Thanks,
yeah. Thanks for coming up on some question.
Great. Well, as we close out here, I'd just like to ask the panel to maybe please just give a 30-second elevator speech to each of you as to why our engaged audience today should consider becoming a member of our first cohort of Avalanche Science students at CMC.
I think this is a tremendous opportunity. This is a unique program. I'm really excited about it, and I think being in the first class, you're going to see stuff, you're going to be part of developing this in a way that nobody else will. And I think it's an opportunity that, like I said, is not out there, and I'm really looking forward to it. And so I hope you join the first class and help us explore the program.
I've been teaching Avalanche stuff now for 20 years. And I have always really dreamed of an opportunity like this, to be honest. But being able to engage with students over the course of like multiple seasons is something I think every Avalanche instructor, if they were given their wish list, they would ask me. And so I think it's just an incredible opportunity. And having been on the other end of it now, where we're hiring and training people to get people over there. I look forward to the day where we've got people coming in with this kind of core set of skills that allows them to hit the ground running. So I think it's a wonderful opportunity for us as instructors and for the people in the program.
Kind of encapsulating all of this, I started in my career in the snow in the late 1980s, and it was a lot of trial and error and grab what information I could and mentorship that I could here and there. And often frustrating and often incorrect thinking a lot of it. You know, so this has been exciting for me to be a part of building a program that I would have dreamed of having been able to participate in. That's really satisfying for me. I think it's I think that we are attracting a lot of folks that are feeling that way as well. It's hard to find mentorship, and I think. Two seasons with faculty and staff that we've gathered is going to be unique and something else, something special. So we'd love to have all of you folks here.
Well, fantastic. Thank you again. Thank you everybody here for joining our open house, and thank you to everybody on Facebook Live. We've got some nice kudos being posted to the three of you, so thank you very much. Nice job. Webinar and Facebook Live session will be posted on our website. And our website is coloradomtn.edu/programs/avalanche science. And if you do put it avalanche science CMC into a search, it pops right up, which is always easy to find. And please do not hesitate to reach out to the campus anytime for more information. You can call us at 719-486-2015. Thank you so much.
Thanks, everybody. Thanks.
Thank you all. Thanks for helping us do this first Facebook Live. I've never done one of these, so it's my nerve wracking for you guys. Thanks for coming
tonight. It's great. I know you guys do well.
Thank you.
Thanks, everybody. Thanks for coming.
This froze.
Yeah.
I think maybe.
So I'm just worried that it's not going to save because we need this to save. He recorded it on there.
Yeah, rebroadcast.
Mm-hmm.